I'm so blessed and encouraged by the Word of God. I got this, I guess you could call this a joke, but there's a real lesson in it too. And it goes like this. It says, a woman goes to the counselor worried about her husband's temper. The counselor asks, what's the problem? The woman says, I don't know what to do. Every day my husband loses his temper for no reason. It scares me. The counselor says, I have a cure for that. When it seems your husband is getting angry, take a large mouthful of milk, swish it around in your mouth, swish and swish, but don't swallow it until he either leaves the room or calms down. 2 weeks later, she goes back to the counselor looking fresh and reborn. She tells the counselor, that was a brilliant idea. Every time my husband started to get angry, I swished the milk and he would start to calm down. It was amazing. What is it about milk that makes it work like that? The counselor said, the milk does nothing. Keeping your mouth shut is the trick.
Thanks, Chris.
Amen. So if you need to get some milk, amen. Praise the Lord of glory. All the classes are released, except for the teens. We're going to stay up. This is so good, guys. And I've entitled the message, if you go to 1 John chapter 5 and verse 10. And that that song, that the first song they did, is that song on there? And I want the yeah, that right there. I want that. So come back to that in a minute. 1 John 4:10 first, if you don't mind. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 10. And we'll be at that. Chapter 5, verse 10. 1 John chapter 5, I love that verse too. We may be there. He that believeth on the Son hath a witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. Now watch this. Here's the title of the message. I'm ringing just a little there. How human religion is calling God a liar. Human religion calls God a liar. I'm letting that hang. Did you know that? A lot of people call God a liar and don't even know it. See, we think of a lie as just something that, you know, we say this, but it's not true. And that is a lie. But a lie goes much deeper than that. When we don't believe the record that God gave of his Son, we are in essence calling him a liar. And people teach stuff that invariably calls God a liar. I'm going to show you this. All right? This is very, 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 very good. All right, now watch this. Number one, God cannot lie. If you go to Titus chapter 1, verse 2, it's in your outline. In the hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. God cannot lie. Now, let me say this to you. We live in a world with people that can lie. And we are constantly being conformed to people that can lie. In fact, watch this. I wrote this down. It is virtually impossible to believe in a God you cannot see, who cannot lie, when you're continually surrounded by men you can see who can lie. See, this is being conformed to this world age, this system. If you don't gather more evidence from the correct evidence from the Word of God. I'm not talking about just reading your Bible. I'm talking about what it means to see Jesus in the Bible. Amen. To see him as that covenant man. If you don't, I'm telling you, you're not going to have faith for the promises. Amen. When you understand who he is and Jesus Christ and him crucified and what a covenant is, faith is automatic. Once again, let me read this. It is virtually impossible to believe in a God that you cannot see with your physical eyes, who cannot lie, when you are continually surrounded by men you can see who can lie. Amen. If your heart does not behold the man, as Pilate said in John 19:5, behold the man. We're going to get into that. Behold the man. If your heart does not behold the covenant man who cannot lie, it will not conform to the one, or excuse me, it will conform to the world full of men who can lie. I'll say that again. If my heart does not perceive and behold, the covenant man who cannot lie will by default automatically conform to a world full of men and women who can lie. I mean, everything. There's so many lies out there. I got the call the other day from a phone solicitor, and it's so funny when this guy calls. I don't know. Hello, is Don there? And then I said, no. I used to say, well, no, Don's not here. So, well, maybe you can help me. But I'm used to this one. So I got it the other day. Is Don there? I said, yeah, just a minute. Hey, Don. I have so much fun with that. Then I hang up. No, it's like, okay. So this is really, really big. We've got to see this, guys. God can't lie. But until this, see, once again, this is what David saw. An old covenant man. That's why he was so excited. When you and I see what David saw, we'll dance like David danced, because it was a covenant he took his stance upon. It used to bug me. I'd read this stuff, you know, he did not, like David, who walked uprightly like David, his father. He did not do that, or he did do that. And I thought, David had a man murdered, committed adultery, took his wife. But God saw him as in through covenant, through the eyes of covenant. And David paid a price, don't get me wrong. It's bad to walk outside that. But we got to see these things the correct way. Now watch this. I'm gonna go to Hebrews 6. I'll just hit this one, and I've hit it before. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 1, I believe it's verse 5, that in Him is no darkness at all. None. None. But outside of Him, it's full of darkness. Okay? I'm sorry, Hebrews 6, verse 17. Wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise, that's us, those who inherit promises, those who are called to inherit promises, He's willing to do that. The immutability or the unchangeableness of His counsel, He confirmed it by an oath. He confirmed it by an oath. Next verse. That by two immutable things, two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie. Now, I've told you the two immutable things, God had, the covenant is secure on both ends, divinity and humanity. The word things there is the Greek word pragma, P-R-A-G-M-A, and it means two parts of a single transaction. God became that man. Human religion makes you that man or woman, or you your own representation before God. And that's when the Lord said, He said, stop looking at yourself. Stop feeling bad about who you are in yourself and start feeling about good about who I am in you. It's called faith. That's why there's so much joy associated with it. We're going to get some good stuff here. I'm going to try to not overload, okay? By two immutable things, it's impossible for God to lie. We might have a strong consolation, a strong comfort, who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope that is set before us. Next verse. Which hope we have as an anchor for our soul, an anchor for our emotions, an anchor for our feelings, right? An anchor for our thinking. What does that mean? That God's promises are secure because He secured it through a covenant, and He can't lie. And that covenant is His Son. And that's the anchor for our soul when it seems like everything's falling apart. Amen. This stuff's important. That's why it's in the Bible. The anchor for your soul, it's both sure and steadfast as it enters into the veil, within the veil, next verse, last verse of that chapter, whither the forerunner has entered, even Jesus, and high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, the new covenant order. Now watch this. Jesus is that high priest. A high priest represents us before God. Represents us before God. One quick one. Hebrews 7:28. Human religion teaches us to represent ourselves before God. Look at it. For the law. Makes men high priests, their own representatives before God, which have infirmity or weakness. But the word of the oath, which was since the law, makes the Son the high priest, who is consecrated or set apart forever. All right, God cannot lie. We're going to talk about this. First of all, we need to identify who is the liar. And we'll see that here in a minute. Go to John 8:44. John chapter 8, verse 44. I'm actually going to camp in one spot, so I'm going to... Jesus is speaking. How many know Jesus wasn't politically correct? He just said, Jesus can... Sit down, Jesus. We need to talk. You obviously have not read How to Win Friends and Influence People. Here's a copy. You are of your father, the devil. I wonder what he really meant. And the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. He did not abide in the truth. He abode not in truth because there's no truth in him. I'm going to show you something here. The devil will use facts to promote his lie. Most error in the body of Christ or elsewhere is merely truth taken to the exclusion of other truth, and it becomes error. Amen. I'm going to show you this in a minute. Watch it. He is a murderer from the beginning. He abode not in truth because there's no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Yeah. That's the devil. Now watch this. Go back to your outline. John 10:10. You know this verse, most of you. This is the dividing point of the Bible. Right here it is. John 10:10. The thief cometh not. Here's his goal. But to steal. In order to steal something, you have to have something to be stolen. How many know as a Christian, you got a lot? Amen. And even if you're not a Christian, it's available to you if you'll receive it by faith, enter into the family of God. For the thief, he comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. That's the thief. Now, most people just limit that to the devil only. I said this before about the Lord. I'm in Christ. Christ is in me. I'm one. But if a person who's not born again or people that are working for the devil, they become one with that God. Amen. Let me tell you something about hell. You will get the judgment of your God. The people that deny hell are morons. Sorry. If that's you, God loves you, moron. Sorry. Because, see, they don't understand covenant. That's why Paul had such an urgency. Not just for eternity, but in this life, but especially for eternity. We just found out that someone that lives close to us, we didn't know him very well, knew him a little bit. We just found out that the lady passed away like almost a year ago. Had no idea. And I thought to myself, wow. I thought he would go before her because she seems so much more healthy. And I thought, wow, isn't life fragile? But see, Paul had such an urgency because if you cross out of this life without Jesus, you get the judgment of your God, and Satan's judgment is hell, which was created for the devil and his angels, Matthew 25:41. Amen? Amen? See, people don't understand that. I'm getting the judgment of my God. Woo! See, it's good news.
Amen.
Both here and hereafter. So the thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and destroy. He wants to steal and kill and destroy your understanding of how to relate to God. Even once you're born again, you've said yes to Jesus, you're in the family. Now his only goal is to destroy your understanding. Jesus came, I love this, he came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. I've said this before. There's a difference between having life and mere existence. Jesus came to give us life, and it's Zoe, the same quality of life that God himself enjoys. That's in your born-again spirit. Now, you got things fighting to steal that out here. Now, back up to verse 1. I'm going to show you this. The thief, Satan, works through thieves. The thief, Satan, in his demonic realm, work through thieves. Verily, verily, Jesus speaking, this is in context, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, Jesus said he was the door. We're talking, now watch this. Any promise you try to receive outside of Christ and understanding that Jesus, the man, is the Christ of God, and we'll get there, outside of the word, outside of the covenant, these are all synonymous.
Amen.
These are all synonymous. Jesus said to some religious Jews in John 5:39, he says, "Search the scriptures, for in them you think you have life, and they testify of me, the door, the Son, the covenant, the word, but you won't come to me that you might have life. Verily, verily, I say unto you," Jesus said, John 10:1, "he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbs up some other way, is a thief and a robber." Is a thief and a robber. The thief works through thieves. Look at your outline. The liar slash thief works through thieves. Works through thieves. Works through thieves. This is why you have to expose wrong before you can plant right in most cases. Go here, I'll show it to you. Proverbs 29:24. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 29 and verse 24. Whosoever or whoever is a partner with a thief. I want to go to 2 John and talks about not bidding him Godspeed. Not endorsing what they're doing. If any man comes to you and brings not the doctrine of God, it doesn't say that, the doctrine of Christ. Anybody does that, don't bid him Godspeed. Don't let him in your house. And the house he's talking about, I mean, you can't test every plumber that comes over to your house. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about a voice in the church. Because most of the early first century churches were in homes because of the persecution. See, some people hear that and they make a God out of home church. Don't got time to go there. It's not about the building. You know why they do that? They don't know God. They don't know the spirit of Scripture. Well, more money. Money's not a big deal for God.
Amen. Amen.
See, we don't think right. Where the world's conforming us to his lies, and we don't know it. We're going to expose it today. If you're a partner with a thief, you hate your own life. Wow. Go to the King James, if you don't mind. If you're a partner, you hate your own soul or life. That's correct. You hear cursing and you bereath it not. The word bereath means you don't expose it. You don't say anything. You keep your mouth shut. This is why people don't stand up against the heinous, murderous act of abortion.
Amen.
This is why pastors don't say anything because they're afraid of being political. We're political. Vote pro-life.
Amen.
It's called biblical. I don't care if they have an R behind it. Some people, the R behind their name means ridiculous. And if they have a demonic, D for demonic, or dumb, whatever you choose. I'm serious. It's about what they stand for. You line it up with the Bible. See, because if you're a partner with a thief, how would I be a partner with a thief? By not saying anything.
Amen.
I'm partnering with a thief when I keep my mouth shut, when people need the truth.
Amen.
He hears the cursing and he doesn't expose it. Ephesians 5:11 says, "Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove or expose them."
Amen.
All right, back to your outline. All right. I can go to 2 Corinthians 11 when you get time, but we'll go to the next point. The liar will use facts to promote his lie. Now remember we read in John 8:44 that there's no truth in Satan? Remember that? But I'm going to show you where Satan used some facts to promote his lie. Look at this. Luke 4, verse 5 through 8. He's tempting Jesus. Watch this. And we're getting there. We're getting to where we're going. We're doing good. Luke chapter 4, verses 5 through 8. And the devil, this is when he's tempting Jesus after 40 days of abstinence, of not eating anything, fasting. And the devil taketh him up into a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. How could he do that? He had been given that authority by Adam. And the devil said unto him, "All this power," this authority, exousia in Greek, "will I give thee and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will I give it." Now look what Satan's saying. Do you know this was true? I thought you said there was no truth in him, or Jesus said that in John 8:44. It's, you're right, there's no truth in him. But see, Satan was using facts to promote his lie. This is what human religion does. You can take facts and form a lie. The old saying, it's in your outline, statistics don't lie, but liars use statistics. They manipulate them for their purpose. Now go to the next verse. If they're the devil speaking to Jesus, if you therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. Now, that's not true. I don't believe he would have gave them to Jesus at all. You know, debate, because he's a liar. But you see, this is what I mean. You hear people on TV, you hear politicians. Now, is this a liar? Is this true? We live in this world. Mm-hmm. We need to live in that world. And as we do, that'll affect this world. Go to the next one. Go to the next verse. Jesus answered and said to them, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written." Don't you love this? Jesus, the living word, quoted from the written word. "Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? But here's my point. Go back to your outline. The devil will use lies to promote his truth. Go to Matthew 12, 34, and then I'll give you an example. Matthew chapter 12, verse 34. Once again, Jesus is not politically correct. I love this. I just love it. "Oh, generation of vipers." I can hear him on The View right now. Did you hear what Jesus said? "Oh, generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things?" Notice he didn't say, "You're evil and you can't speak anything good." Satan will use lies to promote, or truths to promote his lies. Amen. He'll use facts to promote a lie. Amen. "For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." Amen. I'm going to tell you something. This is why sometimes you talk to people, "Well, you need to speak the word. You need to speak the word." And they'll speak the word for a few minutes and go back to what they really believe. Right. You got to get the word in your heart. Speaking, it's part of it, but it's not the only part. Amen. It's what your heart's saying. That's what Jesus is saying. Out of the abundance of the heart, that's where your mouth is really speaking. You can say the right things for a moment. All right. The liar will use facts to promote his lie. Here's some examples. Look at this. Religion will allow circumstances to form its beliefs. Human, when I say religion, I'm not talking to the pure religion James spoke of, but I'm talking about human religion will allow circumstances to form its belief. For example, Aunt Susie prayed and she died. So healing must not be God's will every time. Doesn't change the word of God. Doesn't change the word of God. Because people, and it doesn't mean they were a bad person or they weren't. Listen, we don't know. We're all seeing through a glass darkly. We need to help each other. Amen. That's what covenant's all about. See, people that aren't faithful to each other have no clue what covenant's about. Amen. People that take brothers and sisters to court have no clue what covenant's about. Amen. None. And when you walk outside a covenant, you're opening the door to stuff you don't want to open it to. See, this is death and life, people. Did you know that? Covenant violation demands death. Good news for you and I, Jesus took the death we deserve, but we still have a walk and we need to keep our faith in him. You know, covenant demands unwavering, uncontaminated loyalty and dedication. I was praying about this, said, "Lord, what is my part?" Keeping your faith in the Son. Amen. That's your part. Now, religion will allow circumstances to form its beliefs as opposed to allowing the Word of God to form those beliefs. So many people go to the Word, to the Bible, to try to find scriptures to validate what they already believe rather than going to the Word to find out what to believe. Amen. All right. Now look at this. Go to the next one, the Son. Everybody say the Son. I'm going to show you this. I've showed it to you before. I want you to see this in three different places. Go to maybe more. Psalm 56, 4. We'll just do that one. Psalm 56, verse 4. "In God I will praise his word." You mean praise the Bible? No. "In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me." Jump over to Psalm 105, verse 8. Watch this. I'm showing you something. Look at this. He hath remembered his what? His covenant forever, the word. You see, covenant and word are interchangeable. See that? You see that? Now go to John 1:1. Some of you know this. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. The word, the covenant, they're interchangeable. Amen? Now go to verse 14. And the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now jump all the way to Psalm 49, verse 8. Isaiah 49, verse 8. I still got Psalm there going on. See, this thing's doing this, and sometimes this is doesn't switch the cards fast enough. Thus saith the Lord. This is a prophecy about Jesus. In an acceptable time have I heard thee. Does this sound like a New Covenant verse? Anybody tell me where it's at in the New Testament? Don't look it up on your phone. Just testing you. It is in the New Testament. Paul quoted it. 2 Corinthians 6. But we'll be there, maybe. Thus saith the Lord, in an acceptable time have I heard thee, and in a day of salvation have I helped thee. And I will preserve thee and give thee, Jesus, for a covenant of the people, to establish the earth, to cause the people to inherit the desolate heritages. Now where's that at in the New Testament? Go to 2 Corinthians 6, 2. No, back up to verse 1. Watch this. Remember I told you how all these truths and promises become islands when you don't see it in view as a covenant? You see islands of truth that seem disconnected, but when you start seeing it in view of the Son, the Word, and the covenant, they become one giant landmass. Hence the reason Paul said, I've determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. 1 Corinthians 2, 2. Watch this. Paul speaking, we then as workers together with Him beseech you, we beg you, we implore you, we urge you, we're hanging on your leg, shaking your leg, also that you receive not the grace of God in vain. Now look at the next verse. Here it is from Isaiah 49, verse 8, right here in the New Testament. For he saith, where did he say it at? Isaiah 49, verse 8. I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I secured or help assist you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. You know what salvation means? In the Old Testament, one of the definitions I love is it means to be delivered from danger and into the benefits of the rescue. Amen. Let God be magnified. Amen. Hallelujah. Now watch this. Okay, so the Son, the covenant, the Word, they're all the same. When it says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, Joshua chapter 1 and verse 8, you'll meditate there in day and night. It's in Psalm chapter 1. You could literally say, this covenant shall not depart out of your mouth. Hang on, we're going to get somewhere. I'm going to give you a couple examples. Look at Romans chapter 8. We'll just do that one. Romans chapter 8, and then I'm going to give you an example, and then I'm going to have to get into some of this. Romans chapter number 8. Verse 31, what shall we then say to these things that come against us? Amen. What shall we say? Here's what we say. If God be for us, who can be against us? Now watch this. He's going to affirm what he's saying, why we can say this. Why can we say this? Look at the next verse. Here it is. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. He's putting this in perspective. How shall he not also with him freely give us all things through the Son? Now watch this. Let me show you something here. You've heard me talk a lot about the covenant loyalty word in the Old Testament. We got one in the New that's sizzling. It's all over the place. But I'm going to show you this. Why could David count on God? Look at this. We don't see these verses connected. Go to Psalm 13, verse 6. Psalm 13, verse 6. I will sing unto the Lord because he hath dealt bountifully with me. Isn't that awesome? Amen. You know, this was a verse I had years ago, and it was just pulled out of context. Wonderful verse. But why did God deal bountifully with David? It wasn't because David was so amazingly good in himself. Because David knew how to trust God. David was a praiser because he knew how to trust God. And that wasn't through his merit. That was through a covenant that he foresaw and he saw into our covenant. Hence the reason he was so envious. Now, we're going to see this. Here, go back up one verse. I'm going to read just some of this. But I have trusted in your covenant loyalty. That's what that word means, mercy. I'm going to read it, some of it. There's five pages here. Wonderful stuff. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. Your ability to deliver me from destruction and into the benefits of the rescue. But you have to trust in his covenant loyalty, not in your greatness. Not in all the information you have in your head. See, sometimes we're putting more faith in our ability to have faith than we are in what he did.
Amen. Good word.
Somebody hear that? Now watch this. Now here's what that word mercy leaves, and then we're going to go back to why God dealt bountifully. Here's just some hasid, the Greek word. It means covenant loyalty, preeminently God's perfect loyalty to his own covenant. This is why God made the covenant with Jesus. You know, I'm trying to use different words, but you're getting the key to the whole Bible here. And if you think you can get this in one thing, you are severely deceived. You got to marinate in this for the rest of your life. And the more you see, the more excited you'll get. Trust me, you will dance like David danced when you started seeing what David saw. You will. I'm just so overwhelmed with how good he is, even through negative situations. And boy, there's plenty of them. That's what I'm saying. You're gathering evidence from out here or from in your heart through the word. But you got to see the word correctly. You got to put on covenant glasses, new covenant glasses. So watch this, the word mercy. But I have trusted in God's perfect loyalty to his own covenant. The Lord, it means, listen to this, it means all this is conditional upon a covenant. Everything's conditional upon a covenant. God can't just arbitrarily bless people. God can't just get in this earth and say, I'm going to really bless that person. He can use our prayers to get at them. Whosoever sins you remit, they're remitted. Whosoever sins you retain, they're retained. That's the kind of authority you have because you're in the family. I'll give you a few more here. It's so good. Watch this. It means, it never meant kindness in general to all. Never. This word here for mercy, covenant loyalty, never meant kindness in general to all. Never. We're all God's children. No, we're not. Some people are of their father, the devil. Jesus said that. Amen. But it's available to everyone. But if we're quiet when the thief is stealing from people, we're partnering with the thief and doing harm to our own life. This word is often translated kindness or loving kindness as defined and acting in keeping with a particular covenant. And it goes on and on, five pages. But I gotta hurry to get to where we want to go here. But the Son. Now go to. We're gonna talk about how human religion is calling God a liar. Go to 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4. For whosoever or whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. In other words, there's something to overcome. And this is the victory. How many are interested in the victory? That I am too. That overcomes the world. Our faith. Our faith in what? Our faith in who? Well, Jesus. Jesus who? There's a lot of Jesuses out there. Just go down to Mexico and say, hey, Jesus. And have a bunch of people say, yeah, what do you need? We better have the right Jesus. Amen. Right? Go to verse 5. It's going to get gooder. It's going to seem a little confusing for a bit, but we're going to put it all together and you're going to see it. And you need to see it. So do I. Who is he that overcomes the world? I want to know how to do this. But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. Everyone believes that. No, they don't. They believe it in their head. What's their heart saying? Now go to your outline and go to the very end and you'll see Whoever believes that Jesus, the man, is the Son of God, or he's from God, or he's out of God, or he is God. In order for Jesus to mediate the covenant, he had to be 100% man and 100% God. A bridge must be secure on both ends if you're going to cross it, right? Now watch this. I want to overcome the world. Go to the next verse. Now these verses used to bug these. I'd read it and think, wah, wah, wah. This is he that came by water and blood. Even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. What in the world does that mean? Back up and I'll tell you. This is he that came by the water of natural birth and sinless divine blood. Amen. This is what he's saying. You're going to see that this is a testimony about Jesus. It's not about proving the Trinity or disproving it, as some meatheads have said. False doctrine teachers. See, I figure if Jesus don't have to be politically correct, then neither do I. I'm being conformed to his image. That doesn't mean you're not nice, but we got to say some things. People are being destroyed. Destroyed through wrong doctrine. Literally. Literally. It does matter. We think God had this stuff written in the Word, so, well, we need to write something. I'll just make something up. So he's talking. This is a testimony. By the water of natural human, the human side, and the blood of divinity. Sinless blood. Not by water only, but by water and blood. The Spirit bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. Next, I'm going to go through these verses quick. For there are three that bear record in heaven. Bear record of what? Of who? They're bearing record of Jesus. Exactly. Don't miss that. You'll see it in a minute. For the three that bear record of the Son, of Jesus, in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, these three are one. Next verse. And there are three that bear witness in the earth. Of who? It's the record of his Son. We're going to see this. The Spirit, Holy Spirit, the water of natural birth, and the sinless blood. And these three agree in one. Next verse. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the for this is the witness of God, which he's testified of his Son. Of his Son. He's testifying of his Son. Next verse. Okay, thank you. He that believeth upon the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God. This is not a mere mental assent. The devils believe and tremble, James tells us. They're not going to heaven. They're not born again. They're not receiving the blessing of God. It's a hard belief. He that believeth upon the Son of God, he has the witness in himself. He that believeth not God's record of his Son has made God a liar. Anytime we try to approach God outside of his Son, we're thieves, robbers, and we're making God a liar. Hence the reason many don't receive. Seriously, we're all coming out of this. This isn't a condemning thing, but you got to see it before you can allow God to change it, help you change it. He that believeth upon the Son, he hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth, here it is again, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. Next verse, it gets gooder. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. The Son is the covenant. The Son is the Word. The life is in there. You see what David saw? David peered into our covenant and he said, blessed is the man to whom God will not impute sin. That's you. That's me. Amen. Psalm 32. Paul recorded it in Romans chapter 4. Wow. Wow. Now, leave this up here. We'll come back to 1 John 5:11. And jump all the way back to Jeremiah 6:10. Watch this. I'm going to show you why people can't hear the Son and the covenant. This is when the prophet Jeremiah was prophesying. There was a judgment coming. To whom shall I speak and give warning that they may hear? Behold, their ear, somebody say ear, is uncircumcised. Doesn't hear through covenant. Here's through merit. Here's through intellect. Here's through, well, I'm pretty good because I got enough information. I've heard a lot of sermons. Right. You know what that is? Intellectual legalism. Gnosticism. If you think you know anything, intentionally make yourself realize you haven't exhausted not one verse in the Scriptures. Not one, and neither have I. Amen. Look at this. To whom shall I speak? Behold, their ear is uncircumcised. They can't hearken because their ear is uncircumcised. They're not hearing through the sun. I know people. I remember when I drove bus, and Dawson will verify this. We had people we talked to that professed Christ. Oh, yeah, we believe in Jesus. They couldn't hear a word you were saying. Their hearts were hard, and they couldn't hear it. Nursing home, I've seen it many times there. You talk to them about Jesus. Oh, we got Jesus' word. Oh, yeah, Jesus this, Jesus that. Which Jesus? Is the one on the streets of Juarez, Mexico? Or is it the one true Jesus of the Bible? Jesus the man as the Christ of God. And they're bearing record of this. Look at this. When you have an uncircumcised ear, you can't hearken. Behold, the word of the Lord is unto them. It's a reproach, and they have no delight in it. I tell people this all the time. If you profess to be born again and have no desire for the word, check your heart. Yeah. Well, it don't matter. Yes, it does. I'll never forget talking to a guy, and he was telling me, and we were talking about how the offerings in the Old Testament pointed to Christ. And he said, well, that's good for preachers. That don't have no bearing on my real life. Wrong. Wrong. Everything's there for all of us. And the more you see, seeing Jesus is seeing the covenant and seeing it in the Word and understanding this is why God can't lie. You know, God, for God to not answer my prayer, you need to get this. I'm talking about a faith-filled prayer. I'm not talking about an unbelief prayer. Prayer that puts faith in Him and not in me. That's what faith is, by the way. You know, thank you. Do you know how, you know, for God to not answer my prayer, He would have to deny His Son. You know, for God's blessing not to be on my life, He would have to deny His blessing on Jesus. Because as He is, so am I in this world. Those aren't just cute little sayings. That's a covenant reality. When your heart starts to see that, and your heart's assured, then you have confidence that what you ask for will be answered. We'll see that in a minute. Go back to 1 John 5:11. I'm coming in for a landing. 1 John chapter 5, verse 11. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. Next verse. He that hath the Son, he that hath the Word, he that hath the covenant, he that's in covenant with God through Jesus, he has life. And the word hath is echo. It means to hold on to. He's adhering to life. He's adhering to the Son. Same there. He's adhering to life. And he that hath not the Son, he's not adhering to the Son, to the covenant, to the Word, to the Son of God. He doesn't have life. Wow. Next verse. These things have I written unto you that believe upon the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. This doesn't start when you go to heaven. It starts right now. It's knowing Him. Next verse. Oh, this is good. It gets into answered prayer. Watch this. And this is the confidence, the boldness we have in speech, that we have in Him, that if we ask anything, somebody say anything. Amen. Say anything. According to His will, He hears us. You know, anything according to His will is not as much about what you ask as it is how you ask. How you ask is based on, I'm in the family, I'm here. You know the word ask. Listen to this. You know what the word ask means? Are you ready? You want to know? Do you care to know? Here's what it means. It's A-I-T-E-O, A-T-O. I got it right here. But I want to read it. It means to ask based upon a connection. It's connection-based asking. What is that connection? Sonship. I'm in covenant. You know there's covenants in the Bible when it says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. You know that? That it may go well with you and you live a long time upon the earth. You know what that is? Covenant. Covenant. This is, look at this. We ask based upon a connection that we have with God through His Son. I'm in the Son. Amen. I'm born again. How about you? Amen. I have a connection. Think about your kids when they're in your house. Hey, Dad, I'm getting a sandwich. Well, wait a minute. Have you prayed enough? Have you done your chores? I know your bed's not made. I just saw it. They just...
Hey, I'm getting a sandwich. Now bring this over and relate. Hey, Father, I'm taking some healing.
Amen.
I'm taking some joy. I need some joy. I got it. I know. It's like, yeah. No, you're not. You have a right. You're in the family. It's connection-based asking. See, when these are islands of truth, we will ask. Well, you're just a man. You don't order God around. Our kids don't order us around, right? And this is the confidence that we have in Him. The confidence is in Him. That if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. Next verse. And if you know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, based on our covenant, based on our connection, based on being in the Son, we know that we have the petitions that we've desired of Him. Next verse, I'm going to go through these quick because I'm after something. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not facing death or unto death, he shall ask based on his connection, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There is a sin that's facing death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. It's facing death because it's stepping outside of faith in the Son of God. Now, next verse. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is a sin not unto death. Now, look at the next verse. This is what I'm after. And we'll close here. Maybe. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. Well, that's it. We're all out. It couldn't mean that because two verses before he said, if you see your brother sin a sin, which is not unto death. It can't mean that, right? He's not contradicting himself in this verse. What he's saying, this is a person that recognizes that he's in the Son. So he recognizes that in the Son, he doesn't sin.
Amen.
He doesn't miss the mark. When it says in Hebrews 7:25 that Jesus intercedes for us, it means to obtain by hitting the mark. This person recognizes that he's born of God and Jesus has obtained by hitting the mark that he could never hit. Now watch this. But he that is begotten or born of God keeps himself. He keeps himself or guards that understanding. Tereo. And the wicked one cannot cleave to him or exercise a modifying influence upon him because of sin consciousness. Can you see that? See, the only way Satan can exercise a modifying influence upon us is if we identify with ourself instead of Jesus, the Son. That's what he's talking about in this whole context. The whole context, he's talking about that. We know that if you're born of God, in God's eyes, you don't sin because you're in Christ. And as he is, so are you in this world. He that's joined in the Lord is one spirit. So in your spirit, there is no sin and it will never be imputed to you.
Amen.
But in the cell, out here, you can. In your words and thoughts and deeds, you can. And so he keeps himself in that understanding, and because of that, Satan can exercise no modifying influence upon him, cannot bring in condemnation to steal the good things of God, such as the peace and the joy of the Lord that God wants him to walk in. Next verse, we're just about done. We're coming in for a landing. And we know that we are of God. Now stop. Do you know that? Do you know that you're out of God? Has it settled in your heart? And that the whole world, see, he's dividing here. The whole system lies in wickedness. You know the wickedness of this world is a contagious wickedness? It's a contagious evil?
Amen.
Amen? It's not only an evil that's destroying itself, but it wants to bring you down with it. All right, two more verses, we're landing. And we know that the Son of God, see, he's talking about the Son, is come, has come, and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true. That's why there's no sin in God's eyes. Sin is not imputed. And we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. One more. Little children, keep yourself from idols. Don't allow anything to take his place in your heart. Because what is residing and leading you in your heart is how you're going to believe. And how you believe is how you're going to talk and how you're going to receive or not receive. Satan's able to kill, steal, and destroy by getting people to believe wrong and to approach God outside of the Son, outside of the Word, outside of the covenant that we have with God through Jesus. So you see, God has bound himself to me through that covenant. God cannot deny me any more than he can deny his Son. The word deny, it's in your outline there. At the very end, deny means to refuse. To refuse. Human religion will teach you to refuse the things of God. Did you know that? Did you know that? Hence, contradict rather than refuse to affirm or confess or identify with, to disown. One more. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 5. I'm going to show you that same word. Back up to verse 4. Talking about signs of the signs in the last of the last days. They're traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Doesn't say they didn't love God. See, this is, and see, some people hear this and they get condemned. Don't be condemned. God loves you. Then he headed out to vacation. Different one, have fun. But remember, God loves you and he's with you. Amen. Keep him first no matter what you do. He loves you. Traitor, it says, next verse, look at this. This is the danger. They have a form of godliness, but deny our Naomi. They refuse to identify with the power of the new birth that they have on the inside. And it says, from such turn away. Why? Because that will affect you. And that will cause you to make God a liar and to approach God outside of his son. Amen? Say, I will not make God a liar. Jesus is my Lord. I'm in him and he's in me. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. I know there was a lot said, but you need to marinate in it because it rocks. Amen. All right, you're blessed. If we have the prayer team come up, we will pray and we will close and we will dismiss in the matchless name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christos, Jesus the Christ. And yes, as they're coming up, we're going to lift up our country. I want to pray for our president and our vice president and our Senate and our Congress, all of Congress, the Senate and the House and governors and leaders, local leaders, Lord. We pray that they would live quiet and peaceable lives for that. So we would live that, that they would be godly leaders elected. Lord, we pray for the 2020 election, for the people that are running, Father God, for godliness from our president on down. We bless our president and his family. We bless our vice president and his family. We pray for godly leaders to rise forth. Lord, we are not done making a difference, and I know you're not done, and that you're long-suffering to us, Word, not willing that any out there should perish. Help us all to see the value that you've placed in us and moving yourself into us. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Praise God. If there's anybody here that's not born again, anybody here that's not born again, why, every head's up and everyone's looking around. No, you know, we love you. Amen. Amen. It's important that we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Amen? Amen? All right. I think if anybody, if you desire prayer for a healing, we continue to thank God for what he's doing in Ray Lutz's life right now in Jesus' name. Every cell in that body, we speak health. We thank you that he is healed by the stripes of Jesus. And based on our covenant with God through Jesus, we just command. It's the children's bread. Can you hear the covenant?
Yes.
It's the children's bread. And we are children of you, Lord, and we take that healing on behalf of Ray, and we just receive it now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Anybody else, if you need prayer for anything, the baptism in the Holy Spirit, we make that available to you. Give someone a hug.